I have to say, I'm totally delighted and thrilled. And as I was saying out there, I'm probably still in a state of shock. So if I sound like I'm in a state of shock, it's because I am in a state of shock. It's a terrific accolade. It is the highest accolade you can get, and I think it's a terrific sign of the way the world thinks about the work, science think about the work we've been doing, and about the British neuroscience. And I have to thank UCL. UCL has been a terrific place to be. So. And it's been very good to me and allowed me to do the science that we're all here celebrating. We knew from work by Brenda Milner that there were that the damage to this part of the brain that I've studied for my whole career, the hippocampus and surrounding areas, in humans, led to a profound loss of memory, a profound amnesia. So we had that basic clue. We had the idea that the hippocampus and perhaps areas that connected with it were actually involved in memory. So I thought, okay, we now have techniques, which I was partly involved in developing, for actually looking at and listening to the activity of single cells in an animal such as a rat as they were doing simple memory tasks. And that's what I decided to do. When I went into this part of the brain, I hadn't the slightest idea, and no one else had the slightest idea, that it was going to end up being a spatial memory system. And that was the great surprise. The great surprise was not that it was a memory system, but that it had, in animals such as rats and mice, it's dedicated to memories for spatial events. And when I saw the cells that were responding when the animal went to one part of the room and not the other part of the room, and recorded from several of these and found that one would be interested in this part of the room, another in that part of the room, then I realized that if you put them all together, you would have something like a map. And that would be a really super thing to have to find your way around, to remember what you had done in particular places and particular times. So I remember that was a point at which I thought, this could be an important finding. So when we first discovered the place cells, and we realized that different cells responded to different places, I thought, wouldn't it be neat if they knew about each other and there was some way in which there was a neural system for communicating from one to the other and for providing information about the spatial relationships between the cells. So if I know that I'm over here and I know that I want to go over here, then what I really would like to know is some information about the distance and direction which connects these two places. So we supposed, even early on, that there would be other spatial signals in this system. There would be signals which were representing directions in an environment. How do you go in this direction? And I don't mean just north and south in terms of geomagnetism. I mean ways in which you could actually go, for example, to that corner of the room. And you also expect to have some sort of metric. Is there a metric system in the brain? Is there some way in which an animal and the rest of the brain knows that it is moving at a certain speed in a certain direction and going, therefore, say, for a rat or a mouse, say 30 centimeters per second? And so we suggested that might be there, and we now know. We haven't been idle for the last 40 years, but our lab and many other labs around the world have discovered these other spatial signals. So we know there are cells which respond if the animal looks in a particular direction, and if you take all of those cells and put them together, they form a kind of a compass, which says you're now looking, as it were, in the north part of the room. And then, of course, there are the cells that were found by the Mosers, which lay out this very nice grid pattern across any environment. So if you or an animal walk around this environment, they don't just respond in one place, they respond in a whole bunch of places, and these individual places add up to make a very nice pattern, a hexagonal pattern, which lays out a grid structure across the whole of the environment. So you can imagine it that it, as you walk along from this place to another, one first position goes brrr, and then you go a little bit of silence, and then another one goes brrr, and that those brrps occur at regular intervals, so that other parts of the brain could say, you've gone three brrps, you've gone three rat steps in a particular direction. We know there are other cells instead. There, in addition, there are cells which monitor how fast the animal is moving. There are cells which tell the animal about large landmarks. So we think we have all of the ingredients, all of the components for creating this mapping system. And if you put them together, they enable the animal to do something very neat. They can move around the environment flexibly. So you can always go from one place to another by following a route. You can say, go down to the corner, turn right, go four steps, turn left, and so on. What this system will enable us and animals to do is to actually say, I want to go to Trafalgar Square. How do I do it? Well, let me go out the front door of the building here and I'll go along Euston. Oh, the police have blocked off Euston Road. I know another way, and it will enable you to then go in a totally different route, one that you hadn't anticipated. And we know this exists because we've seen it actually operating in cab drivers, as Eleanor Maguire at UCL has shown. She can show that when a cab driver is trying to plan a route and define a route, say, through Soho or down to Trafalgar Square, this part of the brain lights up and stays active as long as they're planning the route. When they get to follow a very simple route, like go along Euston Road, then you don't need this part of the brain to do that. Simple pathways, routes where you know and have learned them over many years, you don't need this. You need this part of the brain to be flexible, to actually do something which is novel, to do something which is unexpected. So it could be one of the areas of the brain which actually provides us with a
That's a balm of phones, yeah. Congratulations.
Yes, it is, actually. And you can build on that. In humans, it's used not only for plotting routes and things like that. It's used for remembering what you did in particular places, at particular times, what you did yesterday for lunch. And it's also used to plan the future. What am I going to do tomorrow? And even to make up stories and imagine what you might do in imaginary worlds. So it's the basis for a very, very powerful cognitive system, which enables many of the important cognitive aspects of our minds to work. The basic message that I, as a science and now someone who's leading an institute, would try to convey is that I think science is part of the intellectual life of the country. It is important part for its own sake. Going out there and trying to understand the world is very, very important. I think in addition to that, it's very important for the economy. I think we need to have a science-based economy, and the sooner and the quicker we move to that situation where we have basic science, which then gets translated in from the laboratory into either medical cures or into industrial products is very, very important. I think we're making progress in Britain on developing that culture, but I think we could do a lot more. And of course, we can always use more money in science. And I guess that's the sort of message I would like to propose, and that basic science, curiosity-driven science, is very, very important. It's not only very important, it's crucial for all of science, and we should nurture it, and we should try to encourage it as much as possible, because that is, in fact, in the long run, where our cures and our industrial power will come from.